understand movement, and also I want to understand facial expressions. And the one of the main problems that I can foresee is that the increase of aging population. So, for example, the World Health Organization mentioned that the population age 60 years or over has been 11% in 2000, and by 2015 the population will increase 22%. Then by 2015 there will be almost 434 million people of 80 years or older worldwide, of which 80% will live in low and middle income countries. And that might be Mexico, for example, all these elderly people. So the World Health Organization say there are four main ideas that we as a society can improve. Is like change in the way we think about aging and older people, creation of age-friendly environments, alignment of health system to the needs of older people, and development of systems for long-term care. So those are kind of like the problems or that we are facing in the future. Now imagine in probably 100 years, we will be interacting with robots and playing games, not as complex as playing football, but just video games maybe, or for example this area of self-driving cars. Like they, because as you grow older, then you lose mobility, or you cannot, for example, reach the jar or be independent as you, when you are 18 or 19. So that's kind of my target. How can I use robots to help these elderly people? Now let me show you some examples of human robots. So for example, this robot Riemann and Riva, those robots are able to grasp people from the floor, and with the sensors in the grass, they can also weigh the person. They using also sensors to detect a smell discern. And so those are kind of the things that like a person can do, but because this increase of people, of elderly and also people who cares, I think there will be less people. So that's kind of the idea that robots help in this situation. This is another example, Pavro, which can detect sound, recognize faces, identify voice prints, and then Pavro is used in these environments where the robot engage with the elderly by, for example, playing games or doing exercises. I'm working with Now, which is a humanoid robot from a French company called Aldebaran, and it has 25 degrees of freedom. This thing of degrees of freedom is how complex or how simple movements the robot can perform. And also has capacity sensors, sonars, microphones, and cameras to sense or detect what's around the robot. Some examples of Now as a physiotherapist is, for example, this project called Sora Robots, in which Now is used to improve the mobility of the elderly. For children, when they go to the therapist, they get bored, and the way to engage more with the children is like playing with a robot. And I really much this example of Singapore University. This is called RoboCoach. problem that I see here is that robot can now improve, create the movements. But how can the robot detect what the people is doing in, I don't know, in each of the places? That's what I'm working right now. How can I detect how well that person is moving, and if they get bored or if they are doing well, how can I use all this information from camera sensors? So with my experiments, I'm using a now robot to just create this human imitation problem in which I program the robot. I attach these inertial sensors to the persons and to the robot, and then I'm creating metrics to say how well a person is imitating what the robot is doing, and also how well the person is performing this imitation. So basically, the kind of main framework for my work is collect data from these inertial sensors and doing some kind of machine learning, some pre-processing, segmentation, and feature extraction, which I use time domain, frequency domain, or nonlinear dynamics, methods or tools, and then I kind of classify. And in this experiment, I kind of propose a metric to measure how well a person is imitating the robot. So for example, in this kind of circle shaped state spaces, the graphic, the D circle is for the robot. So because the robot is consistent in the way that he's moving, although it has like also some problems with jerking. But when I measure the participant one, who was the closest to the robot, then I can say, oh, this person kind of imitate what the robot is doing. But the participant 5 was the worst in imitating what the robot is doing. So the problem here is, how can I say who is the best imitator, who is the bad imitator, who is doing well, or who is doing badly? I kind of creating more problems now because I don't know how to say, oh yeah, you are like a good performance in doing your movement, but who can tell me that? I don't know, because I think I'm in the moment where I think I have to read more papers and explore what other people are doing, just to create kind of new ideas. So my conclusion for this is that I use this very simple tool, Euclidean distances in the circle shape, to quantify the movement or the imitation. And this state space provides a good representation. But however, the metric is debatable, because I still need to find more other or propose other metrics to say how well this person is imitating or not imitating the robot. And for my future work, which is something that I'm really looking forward, and I'm in my third year now, so I'm going to extend 1 year, because I want to do more experiments. And what I want to also measure is facial expression, because when you are, for example, interacting with a person or with a doctor, all your facial expressions also play a big role. Because imagine you are in pain, you do like this movement, and then so this kind of information for the therapist or for the person is important. But the robot can be more objective, measuring the head orientation or all these landmarks that are created in your face to create this emotion recognition as well as the emotion. And also I want to go into deep neural networks, because I think, I don't know, I'm not a neuroscientist, but I like to explore what is in the mind. So I think that's a good source of progress. So that's it. That's my research.
Thank you. Do you have any questions for him?
Yeah.
angular velocity, which is the accelerometer and gyroscope, and these sensors are sort of cheap. Depends also, that's another technical problem, because if I want to collect data from more reliable system, there are optical systems which are very expensive, and because I don't have really a lot of money,
yeah.
I'm working with this sort of cheaper sensors. Yeah. And the advantage doing this or using inertial sensors is that you can be anywhere closer to the transmitter. So that's kind of the advantage. And when you are, for example, interacting with a camera, you have to be in the area of range to detect all what you are doing. So there are pros and cons of this inertial sensors.
Okay. How well does this compare to other type of sensing? Because you know this Xbox does this.
The Kinect,
yes. But that's more, I think it's more sonar based. I don't know exactly how it works. How well is this compared to that? So how accurate do you know?
I think it depends on what you want to do. Because I'm just in my research, I'm creating techniques to measure this level of imitation. Not really focusing in the reliability of the information. I guess if I buy a very expensive equipment, then I'm going to trust like probably 10 or 15 PhD students who are developing that software of motion capture system.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think it's a question of money.
Here. Yeah, I think you're trying to make it as affordable as possible.
Yeah, I think that's another good point, because if I want to make it a reality in 20 years and make it happen in Mexico, where for example 50% of population doesn't have the money to avoid this kind of
in the social side, how well do you think people will accept a robot?
For example, that's a very lots of European or Western people look this like very weird, bizarre, but in Japan they actually think that robots are alive. So very different way of thinking. And in Mexico, I don't know really how people can feel when they are interacting with the robot. I think like, for example, in 1 year, we will be in robots. We will use robots instead of your mobile phones. So 200 years, we will be with robots. But
you have to start somewhere, right?
In Japan, they are doing lots of crazy things in robotics.
Okay. Thank you very much, Ian. And if you have any questions for him, feel free to approach him. I think during the break, during the lunch as well. It was very interesting.